We talk a lot about boosting manufacturing and agriculture to diversify the economy and employ a big part of the workforce, and about educating more and more Filipinos to take on BPO and other service jobs we're so good at, to solve the so-called mismatch between a lot of jobs in the service sector and high general unemployment. We'll veer away from that tonight and focus on a specific field of education. With us tonight, the heads of two business schools, two of the best known in the country. Our discussion, producing the executives and entrepreneurs who will lead the workforce, our businesses, and the country, really, in realizing our growth potential amid ever-increasing regional and global competition. Good evening, I'm Coco Alguaz. This is Inside Business. Tonight, Stephen Dekrey, President of the Asian Institute of Management, and Darwin Yu, Dean of the Ateneo's John Gokongwei School of Management. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us.
Pleasure.
So I started out by saying that the students that you're both educating are supposed to help lead this country in its economic development. At a time when it's all global now, is that still a major issue? For example, we'll begin with you, Mr. Yu.
Well, certainly, I think we should be preparing our students for a globalized world. And that's something that we emphasize to our students, that they need now to have a global perspective. So it's important to look beyond Philippine borders and see how we can organize our resources so that Filipino companies can be competitive in the region.
So when you teach them, do you tell them that, or do you try to guide them and tell them that you're supposed to help Philippine businesses and the Philippine economy?
That's very true. Yes, we do.
Does that limit them, or does that tend to limit them and close their eyes to foreign opportunities?
When you say foreign opportunities, you mean...
To work abroad.
To work abroad?
Yeah.
I wouldn't say that. Most of our graduates actually... tend to work here in large Filipino businesses and large multinationals, and eventually they form their companies and grow those companies over time. I would say only a small portion actually do work abroad, and the trend now is that as companies start creating regional operations, you know, in Singapore and Hong Kong, our graduates go with those companies, but the hiring mainly comes from within the Philippines.
Until companies start putting up regional operations here, of course.
Mm, yes.
In your case, AAM is supposed to be, and I'm sure wants to be, an international school.
Absolutely.
But a large chunk of the student population is Filipino. They're going to stay here. How do you balance that?
Well, you know, we're 45 years old, and we've been an Asian school all of those years. Lately, because of the economic community of ASEAN coming together in 2015. We're actually focusing on that region of the world, ASEAN. There are 10 countries there. They're going to be integrated in about a year and a half's time. And so we're really focused on that. Now, Philippines is part of that. And turns out Philippines is one of the fastest growing parts of ASEAN. So the opportunities will be here for some of the foreign students who come to study with us, and certainly some of our locals may want to stay. But our focus is ASEAN-wide.
One of my friends who runs the school suggested to me that I should ask, when that ASEAN 2015 happens, there's going to be more, the trade barriers come down.
Right.
You're going to get more movement of people.
That's right.
Are your graduates ready to match up against the graduates from other schools?
Well, I think we certainly are. I mean, we met the business students from these other schools in international competitions, and certainly I can say that we are toe-to-toe with them.
How much of that, I see in 2015, is a challenge, and how much of it is an opportunity?
We're very excited about it, and we also see that it's not something that a lot of business schools have paid attention to,
And even schools in the region?
Yes, schools within. I mean, we're focused on it. We've got a course coming up this fall that's called ASEAN 2015. And it's going to be a mandatory course for all of our students, our CDM students who are development-oriented.
What is CDM?
Our Center for Development Management.
Okay.
We have a master's in development management.
Right.
So it's a nonprofit, government-oriented
yeah.
program. And our MBAs will take this course.
And what will they be told in that course?
They're going to be taught about what the developments in the various countries and what these trade barrier reductions will mean, what industries are strong, and they're going to hear from speakers as well as government people from these countries. So they'll be well prepared to understand what this connections mean.
So it's a big deal.
It's a big deal.
You know, because when you talk about that, not in an education perspective, but in terms of an economic perspective, a lot of people still say it's not really going to happen in 2015. It's going to take them much longer to do that. Is it staring us in the face?
You're right about that.
In
fact, it does require a lot of bilaterals.
Yes.
I mean, it's not going to be an instant 2015. That I think everyone understands.
Right.
But the 2015 deadline is meaningful, and I think much of the work will be done by then. And we're gonna use that deadline to get ourselves going and motivated.
Are you doing anything special to?
We started a course too called Doing Business in ASEAN.
Okay.
And the course has to do with looking at how the companies operate in these countries in the ASEAN. And the course project there has to do with how do you create a Philippine business that can function well in this environment in terms of, you know, what sort of competitive advantages does Philippine have and how do you tie up probably with a company, say, in Thailand or maybe Singapore.
That's one of the questions I wanted to ask both of you. When you look at Philippine business, even the big ones, a very small percentage of most of them is abroad, meaning most of their revenue is really here.
Yeah.
A very
True.
Limited portion is abroad. Very few of them have 20%, 30% of their revenue coming from abroad. Why is that? I mean, you've been educating the Philippine, your schools have been educating Philippine business leaders for 40 years and more than that. Why are Philippine businesses less aggressive than their neighbors? Steve. I know you've only been in the country for a year.
I am fairly new here. I came with AIM in August of this past summer. Now, I may have some thoughts on that question, but I don't think I can give you a definitive answer. I've spent 16 years in Asia. I've been mainly in Hong Kong, working China, working Northern Asia, Japan, Korea, Taiwan, a little bit of Southeast Asia, been to the Philippines a few times over those years. But as far as the Philippine-based businesses, why are they not outside of the region more? I will say whatever level they're at, it's going to change fast. And it's ASEAN that's going to do that.
And so, whether they like it or not.
I think it's a necessity.
But if they're not ready for it, maybe they could retreat rather than advance. Because if the other countries come in here, the companies from the other countries come in here,
there,
we could find ourselves in a defensive situation.
There will
if
be
we're
competition,
not.
No yeah. question. And that's why our school needs to, you know, gear up and prepare people, and that's our intent.
Have you yeah. noticed this about Philippine? Is my observation valid?
I think that's correct. I mean, my the way I think about it is that the post-war economy here in the Philippines has been built mainly on import substitution. So, and that has been the frame of mind of businesses here. As you grow businesses here, it's more of how do we create local products that to substitute imports. The mindset is not competing abroad. And I think that it's only lately when we're realizing that we can create Filipino brands that are competitive. So I think we're seeing companies like Jollibee, Universal, Rubina, Bench, you know, these are expanding in the region, and I think that they're going to create paths for other Philippine companies to follow.
Do your students see that?
I think we talk about these companies in classes. So, and you know, this is certainly something that we discuss how these companies are able to expand in a way so that it doesn't strain too much of the resources and be able to grow in a more strategic way.
How much of a drag is it on Philippine businesses and Philippine business schools that there are not enough engineers and scientists in this country to create new products and new technologies, and instead we rely on, for example, import substitution and imports itself? How big a drag do you think that is?
I'm sure there's an issue there. But it's not just that. We're also in need of more management. But again, I look at the region, not the country. So it's my mindset is really on ASEAN. And there's a very large lack of management talent. In fact, this growth we're talking about, these expansion of these Filipino businesses and all the other countries, are requiring talent that don't yet exist. So the schools need to gear up, and we're going to take a lead in that regard.
I know I'm talking to the wrong audience here, but you don't need to have a business management degree or an MBA to run a business, right?
Oh, it's a necessity.
It is an advantage.
It's a prerequisite. Everyone needs one. Yeah.
It's an advantage if you
Let's take his answer. Why is it an advantage?
Oh, boy. Well, advantage is easy to talk about. Necessity, no. I mean, we know very successful people that don't have one. But we also know companies that put right on their recruitment thing, MBA required or preferred. Why? It's a very intensive educational experience that prepares you for the kinds of stuff you have to do as a manager.
What do you teach your students that make them different or give them possibly an edge over somebody who, I don't know, has a philosophy degree? That's me.
We can't give them an edge over you. So.
What do you teach them?
Well, for the way how the Ateneo structures the programs is that it's built on a liberal arts base. So in fact, for our business graduates, more than half of the subjects that they take, those subjects are common with the chemistry major, the philosophy major, or the English major. And I think that gives our students a very wide perspective of things. For example, you know, our goal is to graduate to train business leaders, right? How you can train business leaders unless they know themselves well. They know their values, their aspirations, they understand the people that they work with, and I think that broad liberal arts education gives them that advantage.
I was talking with a top executive, and he said something that I guess resonated with me, and I've heard it from other people, but he said when he talks to applicants, he realizes that a lot of the schools here teach them the facts, teach them the data, but don't teach them how to think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What does he mean by that?
Well, the question that you asked about how do you prepare students. We were founded 45 years ago by the Harvard Business School. Harvard is known for pioneering.
Ateneo had something to do with your founding.
Yeah, they were. In fact, you're my partner.
We are, certainly.
And LaSalle.
That's
so
LaSalle too.
Harvard,
yes.
LaSalle, and Ateneo. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right. But the reason I mentioned Harvard is they brought really the software here. It was a tech transfer, right? They brought the case study method. And the case study method does a very good job of preparing problem solving, interpersonal skills, organizational, the things that business leaders need.
You should explain to the audience that doesn't know it. Case study is a business case. It's a story about a business.
Yeah.
You study it quickly, or you study it deeply, and then you answer questions about it, or you propose a solution.
Yeah, and in fact, more importantly, it's a real business. It's a case of an existing entity, and it's in the past tense. And the student's question is, what do you do next? The protagonist, usually the CEO or the leader, the manager, has a problem to solve. And so the students go through about 500 case studies at AIM.
How many did they go through in your school?
I would say by the time they graduate, maybe 50.
Yeah, we're very case-oriented.
Right.
And if I can throw in a little theory here, Ned Herman pioneered the four quadrants of the brain discussion and found that executives need all the four to be operating properly, to integrate, to make decisions and have strengths. They are IQ type analytical skills, organizational skills, interpersonal skills, and strategic big picture thinking. Okay, so this is what we try to do.
So now I know why I'm not an executive.
You need all four. And the case study prepares all four.
We're going to take a short break, but more Inside Business when we come back. Stay with us.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Inside Business. We're still with Stephen Dekrey, President, Asian Institute of Management, and Darwin Yu, Dean of Ateneo's John Gokongwei School of Management. We're talking about thinking skills, problem-solving skills. When your graduates get out there, how quickly do they have to use these skills?
Well, the good news is they've used them before they came, so they know how important they are. And, of course, they use them throughout their career, so it's not a matter of, you know, waiting until they're CEO. These are the kinds of skills that any management-level person needs to have. And you need leaders throughout your organization, so building those skills in is really why we do it.
And I'm interested about how, for the first part of our conversation, ASEAN kept on coming up. As recently as 5 years ago, everything was about China.
Right.
Has ASEAN supplanted that?
Well,
I'd say China has become less of a focus now, and the greater concern is how do we build partnerships among companies within the ASEAN region so that we're able to take advantage of what each country is good at. So, you know, maybe one way is to think about breaking down the supply chain and see what each country within ASEAN can contribute in order to build a truly ASEAN product.
For the schools.
I think China's, the story's not over for China, but I think the big growth and the big excitement is. And this being the factory of the world is dissipated, and now the opportunities are shifting. In fact, even when I was in Hong Kong the last few years, companies were talking about China plus one. And the one would typically be a country in Southeast Asia as the backup, the factory opportunity. And so now we're moving it more, the plus ones are becoming more essential, and that's what ASEAN is all about.
For the school, for your schools themselves, what kinds of partnerships, either with educational institutions or businesses here and abroad, which of those are important and how do they help the students?
They do help. They help you raise the standard, the bar. I mean, partnering, it leverages resources for one, but it also helps bring in the standard of teaching and research. And so we're quite open to partnering with schools. We've got a couple of relationships that we're growing right now. Of course, the Harvard one has been with us for all these years, and I'm reigniting it because we need some of their help in some of this family business area that we're growing in. So I think partnerships are very good. I did a lot of it in my former work, and it's very positive, I think, for faculty to build those bonds across schools.
Now, AAM was one of the first business schools to be put up in this region.
Yes.
Since then, it's been overtaken by other schools. You're brought in as part of a plan to try to turn that around. What's the main strategy to do that?
Well, Coco, that's a good... I'm glad I've been here 8 months to help figure it out. Clearly, the alumni and the board and faculty are ready for more. I think AIM enjoyed a wonderful domination in the early days, from 68 probably through the 90s. But, you know, competition has really accelerated in Asia, and I've been part of it at another school, and I've been around the region for a long time. China, Singapore, Hong Kong, they're all developing very quickly. And so for us to establish a major role, we need to get back in the game with our curriculum, our faculty, diversity of student, facilities, you know, everything you do to build a business school, we're working on.
But you're doing something that to some people might be counterintuitive. You told me earlier you're cutting your class in half.
Yes.
Why is that?
Well,
that sounds like retreat rather than a...
In MBA education, the key element is quality of student. And for us, for whatever reason, we can be advantaged by bringing that quality up. And by cutting the class in half, you've increased the competitiveness of admission dramatically. And we're now about halfway through that process. The next class
will be... That's a branding thing, isn't it?
Some of it's that.
You're telling potential applicants it's going to be difficult to get in here, so they want to get in here.
We raise the standard. And in order to raise the standard, you've got to give up some of your prior applicants. Now, over the time, as reputation grows and people see how competitive it is to get into AIM and the level of student you're going to be learning from, that number will go up, and hopefully quite rapidly. But it's a quick strategy to get the message out that AIM is on the move and this access is going to be difficult.
Have you seen any results from that
move?
Tell us about it.
Well, we've always been international. In fact, we are minority Filipino, but we would like more. We'd like more from the area. Last year, I think we had 20% from the Philippines and over half from India. The Indian number is dropping. And the quality has risen because of what I said, the standard has increased. But more so, we're diversifying across ASEAN and even in the West. You know, we've become an attractive